Hello traders, welcome to another Friday workshop. Let's see, alright, so Elnie is wanting to know, is there a way to put a time delay on a signal? So for example, 10 seconds. No, let's see, the straight answer is probably no, but that depends on the chart that you're using. So the way NinjaTrader works is NinjaTrader works on essentially a bar by bar determination, right? So the default mode of how NinjaTrader operates or how NinjaTrader updates indicators is NinjaTrader, its default mode is it'll update an indicator after the bar closes. So if you want to use a 10-second delay or 20-second delay, as long as that delay correlates with the time of the bar, then that is easily possible. But when you start dealing intra-bar, that adds a lot more complexity to it. So if you're writing your own code, you could do that. It makes it a lot more complicated, but for right now, the way the BloodHound has a way to delay a signal using the lookback function node, but that really operates on a bar by bar case, right? So you can delay a signal, one bar or two bars, but not a defined time period, unless your bars are using that same defined time period, such as 10 seconds. So, all right, so Ken is asking about using a stop loss in Raven. So, yes, Raven does have a stop loss. So, let's see, I need to get into my VMware. There we go. So let me add BloodHound onto this chart. So I started setting this chart up for one of the topics I was going to cover today. Alright, so with BloodHound on the chart, if I open up BloodHound, here we go. So I'm going to go to the help and I'll go to the documentation. So we have a page that talks about Raven, and I'm adding new stuff to it all the time because you guys are always asking good questions, and when a good question comes up, I try and make sure that our Raven page talks about those types of questions. So all right, so here's the Raven page. And if we go down to, here we go, the parameters. And entry order, options, trade management. There we go. So in the trade management section, you can see it talks about the stop loss and how the stop loss works. And it also talks about the trail to stop loss. All right, so there is the explanation of how the stop loss works in the trade management section, and I will also show you. So if I add Raven, if I go into Raven here, we'll see in the trade management right there it has a stop loss. So there you go. So you can use that stop loss. And so this stop loss would be Raven will manage this stop loss. If you choose to use an ATM, so if you change this default to ATM and you want to use one of your ATMs, well, then basically your ATM manages the stop loss instead. So you have two choices there. So keep in mind that if you use the Raven stop loss, that your stop loss only gets updated on every bar when every bar closes. So as a bar gets updated, you know, or I should say as a bar closes, that's when your stop loss gets updated, because typically this calculate on bar close is set to true. So once again, that kind of goes back to Sanjeev's question about this calculate on bar functionality. So you know, it has significant effects on all other parameters. So alright, so Ken, I hope that helps you out there. Oh, alright. Yeah, Drew's got an interesting question. I don't think I've had this one before. So Drew is using the anaSuperTrend as a trend filter, and he's wondering how to stop BloodHound from giving trade signals once a set amount of ticks separation from the SuperTrend line and price, essentially. Let's see, and he's also saying, also, is there a way to get entries closer to Heiken Ashi candles and not closing price? Is there a way to get entries closer to the Heiken Ashi candles and not? Let's see, Drew, I would need a little more explanation. Let's see, so when you say entries, I take it you mean when you're placing an order, you want your order, you want your entry price of the order closer to the Heiken Ashi closing price versus the real closing price? Is that what you're asking for? Okay. Well, Drew, I'd say, let's see, possibly. So if the Heiken Ashi, gives you a better price, Phil, Okay, so it kind of depends. I need to draw something on here that kind of represents the Heiken Ashi bar. So I'll just make a real thick line here. Hopefully that works. Okay, so let's say, you know, our Heiken Ashi bar is down here, right? And so the actual price is, you know, the actual price is up here. And let's scale this out a little bit. There we go. So if your Heiken Ashi is down here, let's see. Actually, no, not with Raven. So yeah, actually, after thinking this through, not with Raven. So let me go back to Raven here. So Raven just has a, for now, Raven has a simple limit order function. And so if we set our use limit order to true, right, you can see these new parameters open up. And we do have a limit offset from entry, right? So you can control where your limit price is set. But for right now, Raven doesn't have a way to use something like another data point, or for example, it doesn't have a way to use the Heiken Ashi closing price to set where the limit would be, or a moving average. Right, we're going to have another product that will have that functionality. So for now, for Raven, for Raven, it just simply has a offset, and this offset price is from the closing price of the bar. So let's see, I need to close that out. So that offset, that limit offset, it's an offset from the close of the previous bar, right? So it's going to be an offset from the blue dot. So if we're, you know, if we're trading, you know, if we're entering the market on the bar here with the red diamond, then if you use a limit offset, it's going to be based, its point of reference is the closing price of the previous bar where the blue dot is. So Drew, not right now, but the next, the next strategy product that will supplement Raven will have that capability. All right. All right. So Sanjeev is asking a complex question here, getting into the calculate on bar close, what he's trying to accomplish is synchronizing different time frames, and in particular Renko bars. So I've done some previous workshops showing the ins and the outs and the pros and the cons of using different chart time frames with the Renko bars, in particular the Pro Renko bar, and the issues that are encountered with NinjaTrader in trying to do that. So he's trying to get some clarification. So he's asking, are there any updates? And so to that, no, there are no updates. And that's simply because I think we've already pretty much got a pretty solid answer from NinjaTrader that they're not going to do any more work to their data feed aspect of NinjaTrader 7. So even though there are some minor bugs with it, they said that they're not going to fix Ninja 7. They're incorporating these types of fixes and concerns into NinjaTrader 8. So it doesn't look like there's going to be any way to solve the synchronizing the different Renko bars until NinjaTrader 8 comes out. Let's see. Yeah, so using the look back function node and using calculate on bar close faults is really the only solution I think we're going to have for NinjaTrader version 7. So we'll see what Ninja 8 comes out with. Hopefully they can come up with a new solution to this. Marcy had an interesting question. She's asking, is there a difference between the closing price and this word I've not seen before, the Sycamelian closing price? Chameleon was spelled wrong, so SI Chameleon close price. Sorry about that, Marcy. I thought you were coming up with a new word there. So is there a difference between the closing price on the chart, on the bars on the chart, and the SI closing price in it? No, there is not. There absolutely is not. Chameleon is there as a bridge, to bridge getting, all the real closing prices, into Bloodhound. So that's really what its first function, its main function is for. So it has some other side functions as well, but its main function is to get the closing, any price data that NinjaTrader calculates. So all the price values that you see in Chameleon, and let me go to my indicator list here. All right, so there's Chameleon, right? So under the plots section here, you can see all of these prices. So NinjaTrader actually calculates all these prices. We're not doing any real special work here. We're just exposing them in plots, so that way Bloodhound can read them. So these are coming from NinjaTrader, and they will match the closing price of the bar exactly, unless you adjust your look-back period. You know, in some previous workshops back, you know, where I've explained how Chameleon works, you know, I've explained how this look back period will affect the different plot values there. So as long as this is left on its default set to 1, then the closing price, this plot, will match the close of the bar. And the way you can prove that is just simply, you know, turn this plot on and you'll see that the closing price is always matching. You know, you can just set that to white or something like that and you'll see the plot on top of the bars. All right, yeah, so Drew is just commenting that he's thinking about using the limit order in Raven and offsetting that limit order by -5 ticks. I guess, let's see, let me bring up Raven here and just give a quick explanation. Yeah, so in Raven, this limit order offset, so essentially a negative number or -5 will give you a better fill, right? So a negative number means price has to pull back to pick up, right? You have to wait for a pullback of 5 ticks in this case before your limit order gets filled, right? If you use a positive number, there we go, +5 ticks, what that does, that you know, 5 ticks, essentially that's going to place a limit order, you know, beyond the best fill price, right? Beyond the best fill price. So what the exchange will do is the exchange will convert that limit order into a market order and essentially fill you at the best price. So if you use a positive value, it does not submit a stop limit. It does submit a limit, but not a stop limit. So, +5 ticks essentially is similar to using a market order. It's just going to fill you at the best price at that moment. So, yeah. So typically you're going to want to use a negative number to get a better fill with a limit order. So, so Drew is using the anaSuperTrend. And he wants to stop the Bloodhound, you know, signals when price, you know, moves away a certain number of ticks from the anaSuperTrend plot. Okay, so that's the question. All right, so let me put on here the anaSuperTrend. And for anybody that doesn't have these ANA indicators, these are all posted up on Big Mike's forum there. So ANA, who is it? I always forget this guy's name. There's so many good guys up there. I think it's Henry or I can't remember the actual programmer's name, but he's a really good programmer here. And so one of his popular ones is this SuperTrend, and so that's where this is available from. It also might be available from the NinjaTrader download section as well. Harry, thank you, Heinz. Yeah, so Harry is the author, and also known as Fat Tails, is the author of these ANA indicators, and I think I heard a story that he was originally a math professor by trade and decided to pick up trading and taught himself how to program. And I must say he's done a real good job at that. Thanks, Heinz. All right, so this is the indicator we're going to use. And let's see, let me... Okay, I'm going to make these lines a little thicker and easier for you guys to see. Hopefully that does it. Yeah, all right. All right, let me just give me a moment to clean things up here. Okay, so the blue line and the red line is the anaSuperTrend. So let's ignore the white lines for now. You can see the arrows on here. These arrows are being placed on here by the SuperTrend indicator. So let's see. I think I'd better probably switch to like a minute chart. I think that'll work a little better. All right. I think I found a spot here I can use as an example. So let's use this right here. All right. So we can see that, right here, price is not, price is kind of bouncing around close to the trend line. Then price begins to kind of take off and the indicator steps up. And then we can see we got this long bar here. So price really starts to separate from the indicators, from the SuperTrend plot line here. So this is kind of what we'll look for. So we'll kind of look for both of these bars here where we can see that price is really extended away. So what we're looking for, right, is this separation between the plot and price. So what we're doing is we're doing a comparison. We're comparing how far away price is, from the plot line. And so since this is a comparison, we want to use the comparison solver here. And the comparison solver, you'll see it has this difference section, right? So we can, so essentially you think of it also as like a separation distance or a separation difference, right? So we have two settings here, so you can specify two different separations that are required. So we're going to use the large amount to look for this, minimum separation here. All right, so the first thing we want to do is we're going to put the closing price into indicator A, and then into indicator B we'll put the anaSuperTrend indicator. All right, so a shortcut here is I can just change the type from indicator to the closing price, like so. And the next step is in indicator B, I'm going to put in the anaSuperTrend indicator. All right, so there it is. And let's see here. So my next step is to figure out which plot lines I want to use. There's actually only one line to use. That's correct. Okay, so it's interesting. This you can see this says stop dots and then the stop line. So what Harry has done is if you look at the indicator, right, it's a line with also dots. So this is kind of really a cool way. I like doing this, where you actually overlay two plots on top of each other. So you have the dot plot overlaid on top of the line, so that way you can actually see where the actual price value is on the line. So we can use either one, either the dot or the line. It really doesn't matter in this case. So we'll put that in there. And right now we can see there we go. So we can see that when the closing price is above the blue line, that, you know, right, we're basically in a long state. And if the price is below the red line, or also in this case, if price goes below below the blue line, you know, then we're essentially entered into a downtrend state according to the indicator. Right. So here we can see the same thing. Price broke above the red plot line and put us into essentially a long state. Right. So that's, you know, that's kind of using the comparison solver just to tell us what state it's in. But now if we start using the large amount requirements here, so I need to take a moment and kind of figure out how many ticks this is. All right, so I think if I put 30 ticks in there, that ought to do it. And I'm also going to need to adjust my outputs. It's kind of interesting. I was actually kind of thinking about talking about the comparison solver again and explaining how it functions. So I'll take since I've got a lot of questions, I won't go into detail. I'll just do a quick explanation here. So this large amount, essentially, it affects the two outer sections here, right? The two outer brackets, I should say, right? So for the long output, you know, adjusting this number here to 30, and for some reason on my setup, these numbers here don't change. You see it says where it says buy zero ticks, so that should change. And let me try and get this guy to update. It's really weird. There's something about my Windows setup here that's where the description doesn't change on the fly. Okay, so there. Now we can see the description changes on the fly, right? So we can see this upper bracket, you know, says by 30 ticks, and this lower bracket says by 30 ticks. And the same for the short output, right? So this upper bracket says by 30 ticks, and this lower one says by 30 ticks. So now let's move to the short amount. So the short amount is still set to 0 ticks. And so you can see this inner bracket, these two inner brackets, say by 0 ticks, right? So these inner brackets are affected by the small amount setting here. And it's the same for the short output. So we're not interested in, you know, looking for a separation of 0 ticks. You know, we're only interested in a separation of 30 ticks. So we're going to set this to 0, right? We're going to set this value to 0 and do the same thing for the short output there. And all right, so there we go. So let's see, we can see, looks like 30 ticks may not be quite enough. Let's bump this up to 50 ticks and see how that does. All right. And hold on a sec, let me delete this, return this bar direction off. I had this bar direction on, and you can see it kind of plays with, it changes the calculation, so I need to have that turned off. There we go, so that's more correct. And I accidentally put 10 in here, so that's really skewing things. So let me change this short output down to 0. There we go, okay. So now things are looking better. So we can see, if you look at BloodHound's output, you see how it's kind of varying, right? It kind of has this analog look to it, right? It kind of has this variance. And what this, you know, varying output is telling us is it's telling us, it's kind of giving us a ratio feedback or a percentage feedback of how far price is actually away from the blue plot line. Because what BloodHound's doing is, BloodHound is it's creating a ratio from 0 ticks to 50 ticks. All right, so the way I have the solver set up now, it's creating a ratio from 0 tick distance to a 50 tick distance. So we can see that the closer that price, the closing price, approaches the plot line here, closer that BloodHound's output approaches zero. So if the closing price was to ever touch the blue line, BloodHound's output would be zero. And we can see that as the closing price moves away, the closing price moves away and gets to that 50 tick separation, that 50 tick difference, we can see that BloodHound's output then approaches one, right? BloodHound's output is going to approach one and hit one when that separation between price and the blue plot line is 50 ticks. So right now, BloodHound's default kind of mode is to use this kind of fuzzy logic. If we want to kind of put it in kind of like an absolute mode or a digital type of mode, we can set the small amount and the large amount to the same. And now, if we look at the output, right, we can see we just have this nice, clean, simple, easy output to read. And so now we can see when this condition has been met. So, and let's see. So I think in this case, I think we can just use the invert. And so this is one of the cases where we can actually use the invert to accomplish this task. So we can see now that the invert, what's happening is we have all of these long outputs, right? All these long signals from this one solver. And so as long as there's a long output, then when you connect this solver to other solvers with an AND node, then it will allow long signals to go through. And where there is no long signal, so you can see these two bars here, here we go. So we can see there's a gap here where there's no long signals, and so those would effectively block long signals. But in order to do that, I really, to kind of give a better explanation here, let me use the logic nodes here. So we'll create a new logic node. So let's see. Need to come up with a name here. So I'm just going to add that comparison solver on here, and I really should give this a name. So let me name this. All right, so essentially we're comparing the close price to the SuperTrend. We got the comparison solver on here. I kind of like to leave a short abbreviation of what the solver is. Just kind of helps me, when I go back and look at stuff, it just kind of helps me understand what solver this is quickly. And then I typically like to put the indicators that are being used in the solver as well to help me understand what it's doing. So there's also this description here. So this default description area, let me stretch this out so you can read it. You know, the pre-filled description is just a description of what the solver does, but you can actually erase this and actually erase this and put in my own description explaining, you know, what the solver is actually doing now that I've actually put, you know, an indicator into it and the closing price. For the sake of speed, I'm just going to leave it as it is. All right, so there's our filter. So next, let me just go and make, just kind of a quick trade, put together a solver here that'll just kind of mimic trade signals here. So let's use this inflection solver. And this inflection solver, I'm going to change it to the closing price. So whenever price, changes direction on us, reverses on us, we can see that, this solver is giving us a signal here, an output. And it's giving us a lot, so we'll just kind of pretend that this is like our set of logic that's giving us trade signals, and we'll filter them out. Alright, so this is the inflection solver that's been set to the closing price. And so now if we use an AND node, alright, so right now we're just looking at the raw signals here. And remember, this white rectangle is marking we got the two white arrows on here as well. Right, so essentially what we want to do is filter out these two trade signals on these two bars. So if I take our solver and connect it into an AND node, and at least it filtered out the long trade. It didn't actually filter out the short trade because I would need to add another condition to make sure that we're not taking any short trades when the anaSuperTrend is in a bit, essentially in a long state. I'll build that solver for you guys real quick. So let me add another comparison solver on here. And this comparison solver will be looking at, essentially identify the anaSuperTrend trend. There's actually multiple ways I can do this. I'm not going to use the comparison solver. Let me give you guys another example. So I just went and deleted that comparison solver that I'm not using. Instead, I'm going to use something else that this indicator has, which is the threshold solver. Using the threshold solver, as soon as I switch this over to the SuperTrend, we see that this indicator has this uptrend output, and it's a bull series. So this is a true or false statement. So in programming language, a bool series or a boolean is either true or false. So this right here, this uptrend, will identify when we're in an uptrend or if we're not in an uptrend. And so if we're not in an uptrend, then we must be in a downtrend, just by definition there. So And the way we're going to use a bull series is I'm going to set A to 1 and then set the long output to 1. Right, so as we look at this, right, we can see as soon as price breaks above the red plot, we're essentially we're in an uptrend. Until price breaks below the blue plot, and now we're in a downtrend, and we have the red line plotting again. Right, so one thing we're missing is our short output. So let's set this to 1. And actually, I need to set the other one to 1. There we go. Now, right, so we can see that this threshold solver is now acting as a trend filter. Right? So, if we're looking at right, this area here where we have the blue plot line, if we want to eliminate all of these short trades, we can just take our threshold solver that's acting as a trend filter. So this is the so essentially that's what it's doing. We're using the uptrend filter here. So now when I plug this into the AND node, you can see it's now blocking all those short trades there. All right, so we can see that our long trades here went through, and on these two bars they all got filtered out. So when price moved more than 50 ticks away, these trades here got filtered out. All right, so just to, once again, to take a look at what's acting as our trade signals, we can see that on the first, first arrow, we do actually have an up signal here. But after we apply those various filters, we can see that that long signal disappeared, went away. All right, so I think that takes care of Drew's question. Leo's got a fairly simple system here. It's just he's using a comparison solver and just comparing the closing price of the bar to an EMA 34, and he's plugging that into Raven and having Raven trade that. And the issue is Raven is submitting and actually this is not Raven, but it looks like Raven, but it's not actually Raven that's submitting an immediate that would be correct. Yeah, actually Raven would, the way this solver set up, yes, Raven would submit an immediate order as soon as Raven is turned on, and that's because of the way the Bloodhound logic is built. And so what Leo wants to do is he wants Raven to wait until the trade direction or the trend direction changes, and then submit a trade after. So when you turn Raven on, basically, you're going to be in whatever the current trend is when you turn Raven on. Leo wants Raven to wait until the trend flips, reverses, and then take a trade. So this will be a lot more apparent once once I put this on the chart as to what's happening. So let's see, let me add our EMA onto the chart. So let's see, we don't have a red indicator on the chart, so our EMA is going to be red. And you can see here that BloodHound popped up a little warning saying, hey, would you like to save your template? And because I just rushed into the question, I didn't provide a name here. As you can see, the name is blank for my BloodHound template. So yeah, first thing I should do is name my template. So let me put today's date in there. Okay. All right. So there we go. We got our red EMA 34. And so now let's build this comparison solver. All right. I'll create a new logic template. So and just call it the EMA 34. And all right, so we're using a comparison solver here. Let's connect that up. And we're comparing the close price to the EMA 34. All right, so indicator A is going to be, typically you want the faster moving indicator, or the faster moving piece of data in indicator A. And so our closing prices in this case is going to be the faster moving data set, and indicator B, we'll change that to our EMA. All right, so I change it to a 34 period. And there's only one plot here, so we don't have to change anything on the plots. And, all right, simple enough. Right, so we can see this type of setup is always giving us a trade signal. So that's why Raven is always entering the trade. So the way we're going to accomplish this is to use the crossover solver. So it can accomplish the same thing. However, a crossover only gives us a signal when a crossover occurs. You know, so just by definition, a crossover is just a one bar event, you know, whereas when you're making a comparing, you know, two different data sets, you know, that's that happens on every bar, but a crossover is just a one bar event. So let's alright take a look at that, and we'll set this up, and all right, put the EMA in here. Okay, so you can see indicator A and indicator B, I set them up the same way as I did in our comparison solver. And all right, so if we look at the chart now, we can see that we only get one signal per, I guess, trend changing direction, right? So this is going to be a better way to trade this. And let's let me give a demonstration. However, I'm going to change to a range chart, that way I can control price and how the bars build a little quicker. So let's see, this is oil. I'll go to a 5 range. Yeah, there we go. Okay, so now we're going to have to get into some NinjaTrader settings here. I want to go to Tools. So if we go to Tools and into Options, so in the Options, you'll see there's a Strategies tab. And then there's also a NinjaScript tab. So this actually affects strategies, how strategies run, right? So essentially, you know, Bloodhound and Raven, all indicators and all strategies are a NinjaScript. And that's what NinjaTrader calls them. If you want your strategy to wait before executing, then you know you'll want this wait until flat before executing live. This is the default setting. You might find that this option is selected, right? Immediately submit live working historical orders. Right, so essentially NinjaTrader keeps track of all the historical orders, and so it's going to hold on to the last historical one and immediately put an order on immediately based on the last historical trade, you know. And so that's NinjaTrader doing that. That's not Raven doing that. So let's leave this on wait until flat before executing live. And then there's also some order handling here, so you might, look up NinjaTrader's documentation on this, and you know, decide how you want NinjaTrader to handle, you know, existing orders that are already on the chart when you turn your strategy off. All right, so we'll leave that like that, and we'll go through and do some testing here. So what I'm going to do. So I'm going to disconnect from real data and connect to this simulated data feed. And we'll put Raven on here. So there's today's template. I'll just load that up. And as a good practice, it's always good to take a look at the logic tab and, you know, take a look at the actual logic itself and make sure everything's connected up, because sometimes you'll find that you don't have everything connected up correctly, especially if you're doing some testing and some debugging and you know, some experimenting and stuff. You'll find that sometimes you accidentally leave the leaders and you know in a broken state. All right, so let's switch over to our EMA, and that looks good. All right, close that out, and I'm gonna lock Raven so that it is. I think I did. Yep, I hit cancel by mistake. Sorry. So let's load that up and switch this over. Yeah, we want to look at the EMA 34. So click OK. There we go. Okay. So I'm going to tell Raven to use the EMA 34 template as our entry signals. We don't have any exit logic, so I'll leave that alone. And I guess I'll just put. A simple stop and target in there. Call it good. So this is just going to submit market orders and turn it on. All right, so we can see the historical trades that have taken place here. And so let's see. All right, yeah, it looks like in just a moment here, we're actually going to get a short signal. This price is broken below the blue plot line. Order pending. The EMA. All right. So there we can see, Raven didn't take that, didn't immediately submit that last long trade there. It waited until the new signal showed up here. So there we go. I'm going to turn Raven off, and we'll change our NinjaTrader settings here. So when I turn Raven off, I like to disable it and then close the contract out. That way, disabling it first makes it's just protection to make sure that Raven doesn't enter another trade right after I click close, because sometimes the time it takes from when you click close to going down to the control center, and I'm going to go to strategies, and I will turn it off that way. And let's see. Oh, look at that. I've got an extra strategy in here. One thing I've kind of learned about NinjaTrader, it's not really a good idea to leave extra strategies in there. So I'm going to remove that one that we're not using. And I could tell which one it was because my data series, this one's set to a 5-range chart. The other Raven strategy was set to a 5-minute chart. So I knew I didn't have Raven on a 5-minute chart. Okay, so I just used this enable box here to turn it off. And I'm going to go back into options. And we'll go to NinjaScript, and we'll set it to immediately submit orders. All right. So we can see here on the chart, our last order was a short trade. So NinjaTrader should put us in a short trade immediately.
Order pending.
And there we go. So put us into a short trade. All right. Cool. And there we go. And let me move price up. And then Raven will reverse us to a long trade here. And then I'll show you another thing that you can do to prevent historical trades from being executed as well. There is something else that we can do in Raven as well. All right, so as soon as this bar closes, we should be reversed into a long trade.
Order pending.
And there we go. All right. So let me turn Raven off.
Order filled.
We'll make a change. I'm going to disable Raven. So I'm going to go into and edit the strategy. So if I can edit the strategy from the strategy tab here, or I can also do it from the chart. Same thing. This is two ways, two different ways to do the same thing. So I can go into Raven, and so this other way that we can prevent historical trades from executing is turning the backtest mode off, right? So if Raven isn't doing any backtesting, then there's no historical, backtesting data for a NinjaTrader to be able to submit, an order immediately. So I can turn that off. Set the backtest mode defaults, so Raven won't do any backtesting. All right, click OK, and just to show you guys, if I go back to my options. Right, I still have this immediately submit live working orders. It's still on, but when I turn Raven on, you'll see it didn't submit a live working order immediately. And that's because there is no historical trade data for NinjaTrader to place a historical trade from. So that's another way that we can turn off you know, immediate fills in a strategy. All right, so okay, I think that hopefully addresses Leo's question there. All right, so Leo wrote in a comment here. Let me just take a moment and read this. Okay, so Leo's got wants to add an interesting condition to this simple strategy that he has here. All right, so let me explain what Leo has asked here. Hold on. Leo's got another comment in here. I guess the way Leo has built, hold on, let me close this out here. And, turn Raven off, there we go. So Leo, you know, essentially if you built a system, if you built a Bloodhound logic that essentially, you know, gives you a lot of trade signals in a row like this, there is no way to tell Raven to wait for the next trend change. That's supposed to be controlled in your Bloodhound logic. So Leo, maybe what you want to do is add a signal blocker to your system, right? This ought to be pretty simple. So let me cover this. So what Leo also is doing is he's waiting for his moving average to change directions, right, as well. So he's using two conditions in combination, right? So we've built the first condition here two different ways. So we got the first condition where the closing price has to cross above or below our red EMA line. And then the second condition is, let me just build the solver real quick, is he's looking for that EMA to change directions. All right. So we're going to plug the EMA 34 into this inflection solver. Like so, right? And so we can see on the chart now, anytime the EMA changes direction, we also get the second condition accomplished. Right, so we've got two conditions here. And it almost... Interesting. Maybe this is just pure coincidence. Let me change this back to like a minute chart. So on that range chart, price was crossing the EMA and the EMA was changing its direction on the same bar almost every time. So let's change it to a minute bar. Maybe we'll get some different behavior. Wow. Still the same. Let's see. So I'm going to verify this to see if these two different conditions are actually really occurring on the same bar. So I'm going to put them both in the AND node. It looks like they are. Interesting. Let's see, Leo, what type of bar are you using? Because it really, let's see. All right, I'm just reading through some more comments here from Leo. All right, so it looks like using the inflection solver is a new idea for Leo there. So, yeah, so maybe this is really what you're looking for. I mean, it's, you know, I'd say that this is just coincidence, you know, but both, you can see that both this crossover solver, right, it only gives you one signal, right, per crossover, and the inflection also, right, only gives you one signal whenever the EMA changes direction. And I guess because the EMA is the 34 period is, it's moving, it's a fast enough period where they're both coinciding on the same bar. It's just pure coincidence. So that's kind of working out there. Let's see, originally Leo was saying that he was actually using the slope solver. So let me build a slope solver here real quick. All right, so here we have the slope solver and looking at the EMA 34, the red line. All right, and so put these together with an AND node. And yeah, it still looks like everything's, both solver conditions are both coinciding exactly on the same bar. So I don't see any bars where BloodHound has no output. So, you know, if we find a bar where BloodHound has no output, that means the conditions are disagreeing with each other. But it looks like on every bar, both of those conditions are agreeing with each other. So give an example, let's see what happens if I change the period to 50. Let's see what happens here. this is not turning out to be a good example here. You know, I was really hoping to find a situation where price would cross, you know, cross above our EMA before the EMA actually changed direction. So we'd have this, you know, a couple of bars of delay of the EMA, of price crossing the EMA versus the EMA actually changing its direction, its slope direction. I'm just not finding it. I guess this EMA is just moving too fast. It's changing direction too fast. All right, let's really change stuff here. So maybe an 80 period will do it. Oh, huh. Oops, let's see here. Oh, wait, yeah, actually, sorry, we do want that on false, that's not it. getting some strange behavior here. Looks like I might need to restart NinjaTrader. Alright, let me restart NinjaTrader. Yep, it's always a good idea to make sure your NinjaTrader is always flat before you shut down. Even if they're simulated trades, it's still good to kind of clear that out. All right, so let's restart Ninja here. Okay. I guess it would also help if I change my EMAs. That way, what I think I'm seeing on the chart is correct. Okay, there we go. Now that makes sense. Yeah, I just forgot to change the EMA on my chart. So that's why things weren't looking correct to me. Okay, there we go. Now everything's looking good. All right, cool. And yeah, and it's interesting. There, it's the EMA just moves too fast. It's not a good moving average example here. Let's see. Let me look at the time. This does make a good example, but we're running into 2 hours on this workshop. So, I guess. I mean, I did answer Leo's question here by using a crossover and an inflection. So I think I'm going to leave it at this. I was trying to hope to show you like an example using the toggle node, but essentially I'm not finding using this EMA just isn't making a mismatch between, you know, between the comparison solver and the slope solver. So so let me just put these solvers back to the way they should be, and I'll just move on to some other questions in here. All right, see, Ken has a question. Unfortunately it looks like he had to leave, but let me see if I can get this question answered for him, so it's in the recording. Alright, so if Ken is asking if the market analyzer feeds info into BloodHound for alerts, etc., can a link in BloodHound be created to pull other particular charts? Let's see, now NT has a send to chart button. Let's see if the market... I'm not quite sure I understand. Let me just read this again. Okay, yeah, I think I understand Ken's question. So this is really more of a NinjaTrader type question. Let's see, alright, yeah, I'm just going to use this simple EMA system here. Alright, I need to open up a market analyzer. Let's add a basket of instruments on here. And I don't want quite that many. Okay. All right, there we go. So let me throw Bloodhound on here. So I'm gonna go through this quick. I mean, if you guys need to know how to, or if you're interested in knowing how to use the market analyzer, NinjaTrader has a bunch of training videos on how to use this guy. So there we go, indicator, and Bloodhound in there. Okay, let's load up the Bloodhound template. All right, and like I say, it's always a good practice to just double check. You know, just want to make sure that, yeah, there we go. So that's the actual EMA 34 conditions I want to use. So that looks good. See, number of look back bars, I think 50 should be fine. And let's see. I'm gonna put this on a range chart. Five range, good enough. And all right, sell conditions. So here's kind of the key. Train passing by. Let me close the window. Alright, actually, I'm going to build the long signal first. Alright, so that was the long signal built. So now I'll build a sell condition for when a short signal happens. All right, so when a short signal happens, it's going to be less than or equal to, and I'm putting in 0.8 as our threshold, right, because typically the Bloodhound threshold is set to 0.8. That's the default setting. All right, and we'll label the word short. Okay, and all right, I think that's good. And let's see. All right, so one thing I didn't change is our plot. So we need to look at the correct Bloodhound plot. So this latest version of Bloodhound now has a market analyzer plot. And that's the one that we want to use from now on. Let's see. Maximum bars to look back. You know, I think for most systems, 256 is probably fine. If you notice for some reason things don't seem to be working correctly, you might want to change this to infinite, and that might help. So that will change some behaviors. And let's see. See, the show racing stripes, I don't think this really does anything because it's in the market analyzer, but I'll just turn it off anyways. All right, I think we're good. So let's see what happens here. And all right, so what we want to do is link up our charts here. So let's set this chart to blue, and we're going to set the market analyzer to blue, and see, this is giving us a short signal. Let me just make sure the chart and the market analyzer is matched up. That's always the key thing, is to make sure everything's matched up. So if you want to know, you know, which template BloodHound is using, if you can see, if I stretch this out, you can see the template name is after. So we have the file name, right, the BloodHound file name first, and then the template name in here. And all right, I'm just looking for anything I might have missed. Oh, yeah, geez, there's an obvious one. I set this to a range chart, and my chart is still on a 2-minute. So that would help. Okay, so let's make this a 5 range as well. Oops, a 5 range. There we go. All right. And 5 range, that's on a 5 range. And let's see. I wonder if the market analyzer might be stuck on something. Let me turn my data feed on. Maybe that makes a difference with the market analyzer. And sure does. Look at that. Market analyzer is firing off all kinds of okay. I think I realized my mistake. Oops. So I think I made a mistake on my sell conditions here. Alright, yeah, so let me go back into my sell conditions. I think I made a mistake on, I sure did. Yeah, so on this short sell condition, I used a positive number. And so I need to use a negative number, right? Because the short confidence plot in BloodHound, which I can't show you right now, but let me close that out. There we go. Look at that. Oh, my chart got messed up. Darn it. Alright, let me restart Ninja again. Try and get my chart straightened out here. Maybe 32-bit mode will work a little better. Alright, so hopefully connecting to the data feed will populate my chart. Yeah, it seems like the last couple of Ninja updates, seems like the simulated data feed is, the behavior is doing some weird stuff now. And as I mentioned, you know, when I first started this workshop, Jeremy noticed some strange behavior with the simulated data feed. That's part of what's in this next update as well, is to take care of that changed behavior from that market simulated data feed. All right, so we're good. We got some data on the chart. So let's disconnect and connect to the simulated data. All right. So let's move this market down and try and get a signal firing off here. All right, and yeah. So the market analyzer is, it was showing me a short. Oh, look at that. The bar's already gone by. Darn it. Let me move the market up. And so, what I'm waiting for is a signal to happen on one of the other instruments, and then we'll switch the chart to that instrument. And I got to be quick, right, because 5 range chart goes by pretty darn quick. And there we go. You know, seems like the market analyzer is behaving with calculating on bar close equaling false. Let me just double check this. It is. Okay. False note. Actually, that is correct. False. It's actually behaving as if it was set to true. Calculating bar close. We do want it to set to true. There we go. Okay. Sorry about the confusion there. Okay. Alright. Good. We got a signal on the 6E. So as soon as I just clicked on the 6E, and you see it changed my chart to the 6E, and we can see that we do have a long signal here. If I change it to gold, right, we can see we have a long signal. So remember, with calculate on bar close set to true, it's going to tell you the signal of you know the last closed bar, right, the previous closed bar, not the actual working bar. And change it to the 6J, and 6J, let's see, and all right, 6J went away, and all right, I'm going to make a few more changes here, and just to make sure, I'm going to let the market analyzer work on some more bar data there, so I'll up that to 200. So essentially, this is kind of critical. If there's not enough bars for your indicators to work on, then obviously your indicator is going to give you incorrect results inside of this instance of BloodHound, and so it won't match on the chart. There is a significant difference in how the market analyzer feeds price data into the indicator versus the chart, right? So if you have an indicator on the chart, the indicator has the entire chart to look for data, but in the market analyzer, the indicators only have, you know, this set number of bars to look back on to calculate its data. So the market analyzer does behave quite a bit differently. All right, so let's change that. Okay. Switch to oil. There we go. So we got a long signal on trade on oil, and you can see that it just went away because the last closed bar actually doesn't have a trade signal on it. So essentially, that to answer Ken's question, that's how you get the market analyzer, how you use the market analyzer with BloodHound, and you can see that, you know, with BloodHound on this chart, whenever I click on an instrument, it just changes the instrument of the chart in which, you know, BloodHound is on, and so therefore I can see the signals right away. And the key is to getting it, this link color to match the same. So the market analyzer, I set it to blue, and this chart is set to blue. So any link or any NinjaTrader, window that has a blue link color will change to whatever instrument you select in the market analyzer. Marcy has a good interesting question here. So Marcy's asking, pick this up, let me actually go to the slope solver here. Okay, so this guy, this is our slope solver. Remember looking at the EMA 34. So Marcy's got a question about this against direction here. So we have this output against direction. So the question is output against direction in the slope solver the same as changing the invert from false to true? It can be. So if our maximum slope and minimum slope are left at zero, if they're left at zero, then yes. Using the invert, setting it to true, let's plug this in here. Let's get my chart back in shape. So we're looking at, well, we got a lot going on here. So let's try and focus on the red line here. So the red plot is our EMA 34. So we can see right now, we're getting long outputs when the EMA is sloping up. And of course, if we invert this, then yes, essentially it just reverses the output. So when the moving average is sloping up, we're now getting a short output. And so let me set this back, turn the invert back off. And let's use the against direction. So if I set that to 1, set both of these to 1, kind of the way that the in direction was set. All right, you can see it accomplished the same thing. So when the moving average is sloping up, we're actually getting a short output from it. So in that case, it did. Using the invert or using the against direction accomplished the same thing. However, it's no longer the case if I do something like this. Let's say I want to make sure that my indicator has at least a half a tick slope on it. Alright, so let's look at this. Alright, so we have some areas here where there's no output. Well, no racing stripes. We do have an output, but there's just no racing stripes for a trade signal. I'll clean this up and make it a digital type look. All right, so there we go. So either the indicator has a movement of a half a tick or more, and we can see that when the output is on, and otherwise the indicator is kind of flattening out here where there is no racing stripe painting. But so if we're using the slopes here, and then if we invert this, you can see that it doesn't give us the results we want. So where there was no output because the moving average was kind of flat, we can see now that so in this area here, the moving average was kind of flat, but now we can see that the output from that solver is giving us both long and short output, right? So while it did reverse things kind of over here, the problem is over here it reversed it as well. So it's typically not the kind of results that you want. So let's turn the invert back off. So if we want to reverse this here, then all right, come on, Ninja. Waiting for Ninja to do something here. Let's see what's going on here. Wow, NinjaTrader's stuck on something. Alright, well, while we're waiting on Ninja to do something, I was going to try and turn this simulated data feed off. Maybe that would solve the problem. But let's see if there's some other questions here I can answer while we're waiting for Ninja to do whatever it's doing. There we go. Okay. All right, so let's get back to this slope solver here, and all right, yeah, so if we, the best way to really reverse the output from the slope solver is not really to use the invert. I mean, it works in certain cases, but you can see it doesn't work in all cases. So the best way to reverse the output is to use this, you know, against direction here. So set those to zero. There we go. That's really the best way to kind of reverse, right, these signals here. Okay. So let me put this back in the correct state. Okay. There. All right. You guys have a good weekend, and I hope to see you guys next Friday. And good trading. All right. Bye-bye, guys.